Cognitivists divide thoughts into three categories. We have thoughts about ourselves, we have thoughts about others, and we have thoughts about the world. I like to divide that third category up into even a fourth category and say that we also have thoughts about the future. Because it specifically helps when we talk about the thoughts of depressed people. And I'll get to that in a second. So who we are is what we think we are. And we think about ourselves in a context, in a social context, as well as a physical context. And so that's where the thoughts about others and the thoughts about the world come from. When we look at depressed people specifically, we find that overall, when you look at a lot of depressed people, there's a general theme of their cognitions. They tend to think of themselves as worthless, as unlovable, as failures. They tend to think of others as ultimately abandoning them, that others are not a source of help or reinforcement, to borrow from the behaviorists, which Bandura did. They tend to think of the world as a hostile place. There are hazards, it's dangerous, it's unfriendly itself. And then here's where that fourth category comes in, specifically to help us understand depressed people's cognitions, and that would be thoughts about the future, which are also negative. It's not gonna ever get any better. So when we look at their thoughts, it helps us understand very clearly where their feelings are coming from and why many of them contemplate, if not attempt, suicide. If you think you're worthless, nobody's gonna help you, the world is an unsafe place to be in, and it's never gonna get any better, then the conclusion, the logical conclusion within that belief system would be, well, why not end it? Is this horrible? Okay? Now, the fundamental flaw here is that within that system, it all holds together, but it's irrational. It's not logical to think that you're worthless, to think that no one's gonna help you, to think that the world is a dangerous place, to think that it's never gonna get any better. Okay? Those are all faulty conclusions that depressed people make. And so the crux of the very effective cognitive treatment of depression is to challenge people who believe those things to prove they're true. Okay? To say, you're worthless. Prove that. Show me that you have made no contribution to this world, that you are completely ineffective, because it has to be complete. There can be no evidence to the contrary, because then that would falsify your claim that you're worthless. You've had children? You've had children. You can produce effective members of the community. You're not a complete failure, okay? You graduated from high school. You got enough wherewithal to get through an academic program. You have one friend. If you have no other friends, but you have one friend, there's someone who loves you, all right? So that would disprove these beliefs. Are they easy to give up? No, they're not. That's why therapy is not a one-session cure-all. But cognitive therapy has been shown to be as effective, if not more effective, than antidepressants. And I think that says a lot for this approach, that perhaps the crux of the matter, at least for some people, is the way that they think. Okay? Moving more specifically to a concept that Bandura spent a lot of his professional life on, and for which you have a reading that you can look at. And one of the things that I would recommend is to hang on to that reading, keep the link to that article, or print out that article. It has a lot of things about self-efficacy that, while we might not be delving into right now, because I would like you to just have sort of the overview of it and some, understand the specific components of it, it talks about it in great detail. And self-efficacy, again, as a concept and as a way of understanding and helping people, has been very useful to the field of clinical and counseling psychology. And I know many of you are ultimately going off into the field in some sort of helping profession, and you might find further information on self-efficacy helpful to you in your job of helping others. But let's first figure out what self-efficacy is. And you've got it on that review sheet that you're looking at, so you can write down this definition. Self-efficacy is the belief about one's ability to do a behavior needed to achieve a desired outcome. And let me say that again. Of course, you can stop the tape and hear it yourself, but I'll just repeat it for you. A belief, so it's a cognition, about your ability to do a behavior that will lead to a desired outcome. Okay? Many of you have heard this in other contexts as a can-do attitude. So if you have high self-efficacy, you have a can-do attitude. You say, I can do that. Okay. I want to make a lot of money. I need to be a psychiatrist. I have to go to medical school. I can do that. And that's high academic self-efficacy. Self-efficacy is specific. It is not global. So if you have high academic self-efficacy, that doesn't necessarily mean you have high social self-efficacy. Okay? Those of you who are brainiacs out there know, hey, I can do really well in this class. I have done really well in this class. Why? Because I can't get a date to save my life. I don't know how to interact with members of the opposite sex. And so your self-efficacy for the social interaction is pretty low. Those of you who aren't doing as well probably aren't listening to this lecture anyway, but those of you who are struggling, some of you are struggling because you're out there partying all the time. You have lots of friends. They're calling you up all the time. You have a boyfriend, a girlfriend, multiple boyfriends or girlfriends. You're very social. High social self-efficacy, poor academic self-efficacy. Now, notice I haven't said anything about ability. I've said your belief about your ability. Okay? So it's a cognitive thing that gets built up by having ability, but it isn't the ability itself. So please make that distinction. Having the ability is competence. The belief that you have the ability is self-efficacy. How effective do you believe you are in doing this behavior? So let's look at what self-efficacy affects. Why is it such an important concept? Self-efficacy is an influence in the actions that we choose to do. We tend not to do things we don't think we can do. Okay, so for those of us with low self-efficacy in a lot of areas of our life, we're not doing very much. Okay, and that has a reciprocal effect on our beliefs, because if we're not doing very much, we can't get any contrary evidence that will help heighten our self-efficacy. Okay, self-efficacy also affects the effort we put into things. If we don't think we can do it, we're probably not going to even try. Okay. How long we persist in those actions in the face of setbacks. If we aren't doing very well, but we believe we can do better, we're going to keep trying. Versus when we think, well, I'm not really good at this anyway, we tend to quit sooner. Okay. And how resilient we are. If we can say that as a setback and not as a failure and move on when we have higher self-efficacy. Okay. Where does self-efficacy come from? Self-efficacy comes from mastery experiences, what I have already been talking about. Trying something and doing it. So you say, well, I can do this. Look, I have evidence. I've seen myself do it. Okay, so the more you do something, the more you have mastery over it, the more competent you become at it, and thus you have higher self-efficacy. Because you have all that evidence in your past that says, I can do this, and therefore I believe I can continue to do this. Okay. So past performance is a good indicator of future performance, at least that's our belief. A second source of self-efficacy is what Bandura calls vicarious experiences. I'm not going to spell it because you have it on the handout that you're looking at. Vicarious experiences are also social models. When we watch others doing something, we can then see how it's done and get a sense that maybe we can do it too. But this modeling is, the effectiveness of this modeling depends upon a couple of things. One of the things it depends upon is how similar we believe we are to that model. Okay? Age, race, and gender are usually the three variables we look at and say, well, you know, she's like me, she's about my age, she's female, it's my age, my gender, my race, I'm like her, she's doing it, maybe I can do it too. So the similarities with our models will heighten the influence of that model. How much we want to be like that model, okay? There's an ad, and I always bring this up in every class, so half of you have already heard this. I think it was an underwear ad with Michael Jordan, where the advertising phrase was, I want to be like Mike. Well, why wouldn't you want to be like Mike? He's handsome, he's successful, he makes a lot of money, and so if he wears that underwear, I'm going to wear that underwear too. And they're using that whole idea of wanting to be like a model to engage in the same behavior that the model does. And the same thing would work with self-efficacy.